Biographies don't always make news, but a new book on George H.W. Bush is garnering headlines across the country today for how Bush 41 felt about his son's response to the 9/11 attacks and subsequent invasion of Iraq, among other things. The book will not be published until next week, but we have an early look. For Destiny and Power, the American Odyssey of George Herbert Walker Bush, Jon Meacham, the executive editor at Random House, relied not only on extensive interviews of the president's family, staff, and friends, but also on the nearly daily audio diaries the president recorded while in the White House. Judy Woodruff talked with him earlier this week for the NewsHour bookshelf.
Jon Meacham, welcome.
Thank you, Judy.
You had extraordinary, maybe unprecedented access to this president. All of his diaries, Barbara Bush's diaries, the ability to interview almost everybody in the family. Why do you think they trusted you with all this?
Well, I hope they thought that I'd call it like I saw it, which was the sort of the mandate from the president.
Life of privilege. I mean, he certainly grew up in this family involved in politics, great wealth, but he also had a sense of responsibility from a very early age. What do you think shaped him?
Well, you know, he comes out of the same world of noblesse oblige that shaped Theodore Roosevelt and Franklin Roosevelt and, frankly, some of the founding fathers. You could argue that culturally and temperamentally, George H.W. Bush has more in common with the founders than he does with his successors, generationally, in terms of their life experience. You know, his mother was hugely important. She was very religious and very competitive in equal parts, I think it's safe to say. And he believed in the doctrine, to whom much is given, much is expected. What's really interesting, I think, and I hadn't realized this until I got into Mrs. Bush's diary, is that there was an expectation, there was a sense that he could be president, that that possibility was within the realm of the probable as early as the 1950s.
There's so much about him and his relationship, of course, with his family, with Ronald Reagan, who's, he was vice president to Reagan for 8 years, and of course his son went on to be president for 8 years, but he was very different from them. And this touches on what you said a minute ago. I mean, his view of politics was a more of a pragmatic rather than an ideological.
Absolutely.
View.
Absolutely. Labels are for cans, he used to say. And, you know, when you look at where we are now, and he was part of this for a half century. Mrs. Bush said in 1963, right before he first ran for the Senate in 1964, that the nuts will never love him. And they were talking about the John Birch Society back then. The Republican base was always wary of George H.W. Bush. In 1980, he called Reaganomics voodoo economics.
Right.
1988, he lost Iowa. You know, the party had always, the conservative part of the party had always been uneasy with him.
And he was the one who, after saying during the campaign, read my lips, no new taxes, he went on to be elected president, but when he saw the budget deficit was out of control, he raised taxes.
Right. Mike Dukakis told me a great story that when they met after the election, Bush said, well, I won't be able to raise taxes in the first year. And Dukakis thought, in the first year? I just lost to this guy saying he'd never raise taxes.
It was interesting. You talked to him, of course, about what happened in his presidency and how he was devastated by the loss. I mean, he thought, you know, I guess understandably, that this was a reflection of him.
He thought he was a failed president. I opened the book on election night, 1992, and I would argue that in many ways the 20th century ended on November 3rd, 1992, when Bill Clinton, the first baby boomer president, defeats George H.W. Bush, the last World War II president. And Bush really just doesn't quite get it. Not in the sense that we all remember he was seemed out of touch about the economy. That's not true. In fact, he knew the economy was going to be a hugely important issue. But he says to his tape-recorded diary by himself, sitting in the Houstonian Hotel, duty, honor, country. I always thought that's what Americans were made of, but quite plainly it's not. He was just subsumed with anguish that he had not been able to finish the job.
I do want to ask you, Jon Meacham, about what he says about his son, President Bush 43, President George W. Bush. I mean, he's very supportive, loves his son, but you get him to talk about how he was really uncomfortable with what he called too much hawkishness. He didn't like the axis of evil.
Right. He said, historically, I don't think that will benefit anything. He did not like the swaggering rhetoric of his son's administration.
And then the Dick Cheney,
right.
You know, who he it turns out he felt was had too much influence in his son's administration.
George H.W. Bush said that he believed that Cheney was responsible for a good bit of that hawkish image, and that he wished that Cheney had not had as much influence, that he didn't think Cheney should have had his, quote, own State Department, and that vice president shouldn't do that. When I took that to Vice President Cheney, he read it and said, fascinating.
But when you took it to President Bush 43, George W. Bush, what did he say?
Well, he said that he never, his father had never said that to him. He said it would have been out of character for his father to say, hey, you got to rein in Cheney, he's ruining your administration, that conversation never took place.
He was publicly supportive of going into Iraq, the decision to invade Iraq in 2003, but he clearly had misgivings about it.
He had what a friend called anxieties. He was anxious about it. He also privately wrote his son a note saying that if the man won't comply, meaning Saddam, then you have to do what you have to do. And one of the things about that that I think historically is important is George H.W. Bush had his own war with Saddam, in which he was quite unilateral. He was willing, one of the things that emerges in the president's diary is that on five or six different occasions, he talks about how he would be willing to be impeached, that even if the Congress said in 1990, 91, we're not authorizing the use of force, he was willing to go. And the first Bush to talk about Saddam in terms of good versus evil was not George W. Bush,
right,
but Bush 41.
Was the father.
Right.
And yet he went on to have, as you said, anxieties about what his son did after 9/11.
One of the key things about Bush 41 is this sense of deference to whomever the president happens to be at a given moment. He believed that his son was confronting something that no president since Lincoln had done, which was warfare on American soil.
And you've talked to him a lot since he left office, which was, what, 23 years ago. What does he say about the hyper-partisanship in Washington now?
It worries him enormously because he saw it happen as he was governing. It happened right around him. I mean, the rise of Gingrich, the rise of freelance partisanship happened when he was willing to take the political heat, break the Read My Lips pledge, do what he thought was best for the country. That's one of the key things about George Bush, is no matter how you feel about how he campaigned, and he was a tough campaigner. In fact, he talks in his diary about, I'm stronger, I'm tougher. If I'd kept letting the press define me as a wimp or a loser, I wouldn't be here, almost winning in 1988. But once he was in office, he tried to put the country first, and he acted against his own political interest. The great example is the 1990 budget deal.
Right.
He had run against raising taxes, he got into it, he saw he needed to, so he did that, and he knew at the time it could cost him re-election.
You said to me just finally a moment ago, this may be the last time a president gives this kind of access while he or she is still alive.
It's possible. It's these kinds of diaries are unique. He kept audio diaries throughout his episodically as vice president, and then fairly regularly as president. There are all sorts of legal issues with that, and who listens to them. But this is as close as many of us, I think, are going to get to actually sitting in the Oval Office. This is him talking moments of great triumph, at moments of tragedy. It's a remarkable historical document, his presidential diary, because it's as high politics really is, but we so rarely get to see, and here we do.
The book is Destiny and Power, The American Odyssey of George Herbert Walker Bush. Jon Meacham, thank you for bringing it to us.
Thank you, Judy.